Hello again. Happy to see you here. The next speaker is Ben. You probably all know him. He's the community manager of Typo3. And he's going to talk about play to innovate. And I'm really keen on his talk. Give him an applause, please.
Thank you. So before we really start, I would like you all just to close your eyes for a moment. I will also do that. And take a deep breath and imagine that you're an excellent innovator. You're at an innovation conference together with Bill Gates and Steve Jobs and Edison and Ford and whoever. So just think about this for a few seconds. You are the best innovator ever. You're surrounded by innovators. All right. So open your eyes. So what are the first thoughts that you have now as being a very good innovator? Anybody? Yep. Okay. So if I would think about it, so myself, I would say I'm energized to do new things. So anybody else? An idea. If you would be an innovator, come up with some things. Sir, what would you think? Okay. And you're thinking about gaming, probably. Okay. Anybody else? What do you just feel? Sorry? Okay, that's a very good point. Thank you. Anybody else? Yeah. Maybe not such a big task. So anybody else? Just have an idea. What would you do if you have to invent something? Or just have to think about something? Invent a new Tesla? Any idea? One last one. Okay, so also a difficult task, probably, you think. All right, anybody else wants to add something to that? Sorry? Okay, so let's do that. So, I came across this quote of Ray Bradbury, and in an interview, and I was working on this presentation, so I've been working for a very long time in this presentation, really thinking about what innovation is and what playing is. And Ray Bradbury, so he's a science fiction writer, has got a lot of very good books on his name. He said, work has got to be play or it doesn't work. And in this interview, I found it really interesting that the interviewer asked him, will you ever have a writer's block? Do you know this? And he said, no, I never have a writer's block, because there's always something to write about. So there's always something to investigate. There's always something for him personally to check out. So I put this on Twitter, I think yesterday or the day before, and I got some very interesting reactions to this. So I think somebody said, what have you been smoking? when I wrote this down. So so there's a lot of misinterpretation, you know, what actually I think I actually posted work has got to be fun or it doesn't work. So actually, what is the interpretation of playing? Maybe that's also a good question to ask you guys. What would you say about playing, Christian?
Trying things I couldn't.
Exactly, very good.
Trying out things I couldn't do in my life.
Yeah. Okay, very good. Just trying new things.
Overcoming challenges.
Mr. Game himself.
Okay. Where you're able to explore to some extent you can't do in the real world.
Okay, so in a protected environment.
You can do things without the pressure. You can start doing things without the pressure of having success.
Okay, really good. So a nice environment. So playful is fun, and that is a nice environment. Caroline, you maybe?
I think that most of it has been said.
Okay.
Dare to fail.
Exactly. That's a very good point. I need an assistant. That would be a good one. No, it's totally fine.
I think it's very important that you have rules in a game and still you are able to break the rules, and that's very difficult in reality.
Okay.
So breaking the rules sometimes leads to a lot of innovation.
Excellent. I would say so as well. Just let's see where we go. So I'm kind of finished with this round. So innovation is all around us. There's some really interesting experiments just, you know, by, like we started this conversation, just taking a deep breath and looking around you. There's so many things which we kind of assume, you know, are the way they are, but are very different. I had a nice experience this morning or yesterday. So I have this paper and my tablet failed, and I was really thinking, I have to, I put a presentation on the tablet, which is not so conspicuous as some paper. And I've been thinking for 1.5 hours, my tablet failed, now what do I need to do? Do I need to have another laptop or whatever? So it took me like 1.5, 2 hours to realize that I could also print it. So this is sometimes a rut we are in. So sometimes we are thinking very crazy. So I also found in my room this very simple innovative thing. I think it's only in the Netherlands, maybe you know it. So this is, we have very complicated innovations like this wonderful remote. This is just a bottle with one glass. And so these are things, you know, which I found, actually I wanted this as a speaker gift. But I think for Volker it was probably a little bit too low tech. But this is interesting, you know, how this just came into being from a very simple thought, probably. So that brings me to innovation in general. So what I found out when checking out innovation, and we are not going to talk actually about product innovation, but we kind of will end up in personal innovation. So how can you change yourself, leading a playful life, to be able to innovate. So what I also found out, so that innovation started already, of course, a very long time ago, and there are some examples that you know, like the creation of the invention of the light bulb or the horseless carriage, which has been not really a necessity, but kind of got into being, kind of got into existence from one day to the other, or one week to the other. But these days, innovation is really a necessity. So we really have a very high speed of living. It's a little bit like Alain showed in this presentation with the graph where technology has gotten to a very high point, and we will see masses are a little bit behind. So there are also many things that we have in daily life that we really need to address. Like global warming and things like this, and that we are not living on a highway to hell, or it seems like this sometimes, but there's a lot of things that we can do with innovation. So, talking about playing, it's exactly what Søren also mentioned. Playing can be many different things. It can involve strategies, sometimes simple, sometimes very complex. We have some guidelines. Some games teach you everything you need to know before you begin. In others, you learn to play as you play to win. So, what kind of started me in this presentation is also that I saw in the Type 3 community that we kind of got stuck, at least with CMS, in some progress. And I think we are on the right way currently to find some project progress again. And it was really interesting to see that Benny, now for the CMS team, has determined the values to embrace and innovate. So this is something that we really do if you look around us, and to try to find some points for innovation, we always we usually don't invent things really new. We reassess, we reinterpret, we just look around us, what can we improve and redo? So one of the things why I call it play to innovate, it's based on an old saying, you might all know, it's play to win. So what was something used, I think, like 10 or 20 years ago, in a lot of cases, is if we do something, we do it to win, to gain financial things, whatever. And what we do these days, at least, there's a lot of innovation going on. You cannot see the news or, especially here, it's all about innovation. I think that's a win-win-win situation. Because the innovation itself brings you a lot. The goal, you know, exactly what you will reach. There are some very interesting things that are being developed. And also your personal innovation. So for me, that is totally a win-win-win situation. So, what I'm going to do is show you three steps. So, play to innovate is for me, is reaching the goal, it's playing itself, and it ends up with you being able to innovate. So, innovation is essential for projects these days to keep their credibility and their market share. So this is exactly something which goes for Type 3 CMS. I think with NEOS we see there's so much innovation that people are, at least currently, not able to handle all that innovation. So especially with the change, with the pace that we have currently, we see in the digital world it gets an increasingly bigger part in our real world. So we are partly in the matrix. Innovation is very necessary to solve the problems that we are facing today. We have a unique possibility to tackle these problems with the communication, the digital world, and especially the internet offices. So we have companies like Google that make use of the internet as a huge network and collecting big data. So unfortunately, I was not at the keynote today because I was kind of, I had to prepare my own thing. But I heard that was really about exactly this thing, gathering big data and dealing with that and looking for solutions even before the problems arise. This morning was in the news. Google, Oracle, you know this whole thing about Google using Java, and this morning was in the news that Google went to the Supreme Court in the USA to cancel this whole court case, and one of their main reasons was why they want this is that they want to clear the path for innovation. So if they will not be able to use, let's say, a language that's used so commonly, then a lot of people will not be able to do the innovation. And this also clearly touches upon what Alain said in his presentation, that everything needs to be open source. And I think this is something I hope we reach. I think there are very good chances because the judicial system in the US seems to be much more susceptible to things like this. If you see trolling, there are many of these cases overturned, and which 10 years ago, all the big trolls and big companies won. This is kind of turning around. So we also see, of course, in innovation, we have stuff like Google X Labs, where Google Glass came from, and where they even are working on hoverboards, you know, like we have from Back to the Future. So that's really interesting, and there you can really see innovation is about coming up with crazy stuff, and maybe if you 10% of that you can realize, then you're on a good way. So, innovation is something that can happen by accident, so like we have seen in the beginning of the century, but it's also something that we could really search for, so by gaming. Another thing that I also came across is that innovation, so we can do that, I think we are all very lucky that we are in a technical environment and that we can really relate to the stuff that's going on, but something that I found really remarkable is that a lot of companies are not able to deal with that. So what I read from an article in Wired just last week is that like 90% of companies totally lack digital skills. So they're totally not able to participate in the technical arena. And this is something which is also quite remarkable in the government space. So there's almost no one in higher government positions that have any knowledge about technical issues whatsoever. So innovation is a concern, Many organizations continue to lean on traditional methods to build skills, such as recruitment drives and training. More ethical methods, such as targeted company acquisitions, and more innovative approaches, such as setting up startups, incubators, are relatively unused, with just 13% of companies tapping into such approaches. So it's really interesting, there's a huge gap there to serve, so to speak. So a few examples of innovation, of things that already happened and we might still do. So there's this example of the ancient city, Mayan city of Tikal. Maybe someone has heard of that. It was a very big city of 200,000 people, which in 800 AD, so after Christ, totally perished. So and it was very hard for scientists to find out what actually happened, because it was in a totally overgrown jungle. So it was very hard to determine the cause, but after some years of investigation, they found out that when the city was growing, everyone is chopping the wood around the city, which caused droughts, and then everyone was gone, there was nothing to eat from, and that's the way this city perished. So we are also facing this kind of problems, which we can tackle if we can get a long-term idea. At least don't think in the short term. So the world's most critical challenges, including population growth, peak oil, climate change, and limits to growth, could be met by encouraging innovation. A company like Google and, of course, Apple built their business on innovation and the trust users have that they will provide the best tools to deal with the world we are living in. So things that are fixed by innovation, for instance, energy, not totally fixed, but we can definitely see that because of innovation, the amount of watts that come from solar power, the cost for that decreased from like $20 to $1 per watt over the last 30 years, and this will only increase. So water, the amount of energy it takes to desalinate a liter of water has dropped by a factor of 9. And that's very important, of course, because we will see in the future shortages of water. Pollution of rivers is one. So I was just this morning watching this video of, I think it was a burning river in 1952 something. So it's really interesting. If you look for that polluted river, at a certain stage it got just so far that only a spark from a moving train just lit up a whole river. And actually the situation currently is that many rivers, no, not all rivers, maybe not the rivers in China, but there's a lot of rivers that are cleaner than ever before. Even the ozone layer, which we were really very worried about years and years and years ago, it seems to be in a relatively good shape. Acid rain was also something that was of a very big concern, like I can remember 30 years ago. I remember sometimes, indeed, on my bicycle through the rain, that I got tears in my eyes because of the acid rain from the Ruhr area. But this is also not the case, at least not in our area, maybe in China it still is. So, but there's still some challenges ahead for innovation, which is, for instance, food supply, and there's a lot of stuff going on with genetics, of course, which we don't want any part of. But there are also a lot of other innovative approaches to be able to create a bigger food supply. And the energy thing is really something very interesting, because I think we will see in the future that we can really be independent of fossil fuels. I mean, if you see how much energy the Earth hits, maybe I think in 1.5 hour, if you would be able to tap into an area and harvest that sun energy, then we'll be totally free of fossil fuels. This will be something for the future that will totally happen. Of course, then we have world peace that we need, but how we will reach that, I don't know. So what we need to do is try to encourage open-ended behavior. So we talk about goals, and sometimes though only the path to the goal is most important. So it's not about goals, it's about pushing the boundaries and discovering something. So it's less about the object goal and more about the experience, the story of that object. It's about looking for social and environmental cues as to what experience is or could be. So, now it's time to play, so to do the experience, and exactly The work is got to be played or it doesn't work, it comes in here. I'll have a little something for you. So luckily we're not with 100 people. I had to bring this before, but I have a few notepads, which I'll just quickly share around. Just if you can distribute that. Sorry. Jullie ook. Ja ook. So what I would like you to do, do you have pens at hand? Okay. Just pair up if you want, so if you don't want, that's also fine. With two people, just sit next to each other. And I was thinking that my talk would be short. Just team up with somebody. If you like, it's not really necessary. You are the gaming man, so. You can take the rest home with you if you want. All right. Pens, everybody have a pen? Pen. Raise your hand if you don't have one. Excellent. So what are we going to do? Do we have pairs? You just sit together if you want. Everybody has a pen? So now what we are going to do. Oh, excellent. So I would like you to draw your neighbor's face. So you can already hear the buzz of creativity. People are laughing, that's good. So if something gets created, then if people laugh, that's a very good sign. Excellent. 30 seconds. Very good. So.
You should do the drawing stuff on the first day.
20 seconds. It's not important, we'll get there. Yeah, creativity is here. Ten seconds. Everybody doing okay? Five. Four. Okay, now show your drawing to your neighbor. Hey. So. who thinks he's a really good drawer? Who is a good artist? Yeah? Okay. Well, this is, so it's really great to do this. I'm really happy that I did it because I think actually doing a presentation with all the slides, I find very boring actually. So I'm really happy to see that it totally works because we see a lot of people getting creative and laughing, but we also see people that are really embarrassed, you know, by their skills. So actually, I still want to know you. Who is a good artist? Who can do good drawing? Not really. Everybody's too modest. Very well, sir. So this is about innovation. You can really see here that some people are embarrassed to take the leap to do something. Other people are really enthusiastic. So this gives you a little bit of an impression, you know, if you would need to take a challenge to get into something, that these are the things that you stumble upon. This is a really simple exercise. I have one more, which is also very interesting, but this is, yeah. Yeah, but that's really fun, not embarrassing at all. So, we have been playing around a little bit. Maybe I can also explain a little bit that I got some reactions from people that said, okay, this will be about gamification. No, it's not. And actually, if I think about myself and games, I hate games. Really. So, but maybe that's because of my attention span. I cannot really stay focused on something for a very long time. It depends a little bit on the topic, but that's not my thing. But What I always did really like is to play for days with Lego or dominoes, is to only see, you know, how the dots would look. So I really consider this playing. We asked the question before, what exactly is playing? That could be a scavenger hunt, or this could be playing dominoes, or so many things, but it's all in creative direction. So innovative work cannot happen without trial and error. So that's what we kind of did. Experimentation and some fooling around. First off, when it's with the play, I already did that. What does it mean to you? I kind of explained it. Many things are possible. So most people think that the opposite of play is work, especially in the corporate world. But the opposite is boredom or even depression. To me, play is what you're passionate about doing. So we need passion, you know, to do some innovation. You want to do it because it's enjoyable, and you want to keep doing it because it brings you joy. So this is something, of course, that you would really like when we work. So three things if you do this. Like a bit of exercise that we do. It's if you want to innovate, you act in roles, you do a role play, you think ridiculous, and you think with your hands. This is something Henny and me also talked about. This is very important. We don't have a laptop and only write things there, but just use a pen and use your creativity. It comes out of your fingers and not out of your keyboard. So there are many companies these days that kind of use these methods. It's really interesting to hear Jürgen about what they do. You have companies like IDEO, this innovation with design. Five, all right. And there's one company I really like, which I think you should check out. So after the talk, I will post that. That's Buffer. Buffer is a social media application where you can time your social media output, Facebook, Twitter, and all that kind of thing. But they're very remarkable in that everything that they do, they share. So every knowledge that they have concerning using graphics or whatever you can do on the internet, they share. Even their model they have for managing their company or unmanaging their company, they post. I will post the link and you should check it out. I think there's something for everybody to check out there. So, pen and paper. Just quickly. So we have the pair. So one of you will make a list of things that you'll find in your garage. So, you know, think about what you have in your garage. So one of the persons, not both of you, but one of you. And the other one writes articles from a supermarket, what you will find in a supermarket. Just write on a list, like 10 items. For your bike shed or something like this. The tooling from your shed, tools. From someone else's garage. Ten at the most. If you have four, it's also okay. All right, so let's have it. Everyone can continue, but I want to hear a first result.
Apple car.
Apple car. Yes. For transporting apples?
Either that or manufactured by Apple.
No. Okay, very good one.
We did it in an other way.
Okay.
Once in the supermarket had some fruits and vegetables, and I have some Blumenerde and a flower pot in my garage, so we can make new fruits and new vegetables for the future.
Excellent. Seems like a very good sustainable product. Who?
We found a terrace heater, a heater for the terrace in my keller, and we can add his food from the supermarket in a can. You can hang at the heater to heat the cans or to heat warm wine in the winter or whatever.
Excellent. For the really terrible times. You guys have something?
The bicycle in the garage and the bratwurst in the supermarket, and we build a bratwurst holder for the bicycle, so while you ride the bike.
Excellent. We can market that right away, I'm really sure. We'll get back to, we'll talk about this after the presentation, okay? Really great.
We have an innovative bread car because everyone is annoyed of walking to the bakery, so there's a delivery service which delivers the bread.
This is incredible. Who would have thought about the delivery service? Nobody here.
We have a sofa bicycle with a beer cooler.
Excellent. So you see, with not that much effort, we can get to really great ideas. So, this kind of wraps it up for the play section. So let's go through the you section. You, so you practice, so let's go through it quickly. So the thing is, what I found out is that innovation, we can read a lot about innovation, but I think we are not really capable of doing any innovation before we free ourselves, really. So that we really have the freedom to think what we want to think and to also to distance ourselves from what we think. So this also has a little bit to do with Kasper said in his keynote. Sometimes we need to step back and really think about the things that are going on around us. So there are a number of things that we can do now to start innovating. So I'll just read aloud what I had. I also posted it in my blog a few weeks ago. So what is very beneficial if you want to start innovating is just, there are very simple things. Read how others do it. So there are some amazing books about this, which really have a lot of impact. Take a course, read a book you would normally never read. So take that challenge. So a lot of innovation is a lot about taking the challenge. You see a book, I don't exactly know what it is about, just start reading it and you find some amazing things for sure. Maybe it's not Harry Potter that you want to read or something, but something which is very good is to ask a child. This will also say a lot of times with innovation, if you want to innovate, have a child's mind. Child's mind is empty, so when we start thinking about things, we are not disturbed by all the thoughts that we have. So ask a child, paint a picture. This is all, this strongly relates to the creative stuff. Write something. I personally find this very strong. I think the last year I'm really doing quite a lot of blogs, and for me that really functions because during the day I also start to think, you know, what can I actually write? Get up at 5:20 in the morning. I remember the presentation we had last year about the Smashing Magazine guy. I found that really, I think that inspired me also a little bit to get up at 5:20, and that works. Because it's a very calm time, you can really set your mind to some stuff. Meditate. So, I don't know, you can really, it's not necessary to meditate half an hour. What you can do is just in the morning, I would say, you know, if you want to take some time, just sit for 1 minute on the edge of your bed and just think about what you're going to do this day. That is also already meditation. Take your time sometime. Accept who you are. Okay. Difficult sometimes. And the last one I think is the most powerful ever is assume everything you know is wrong. Which is the case in most cases. So, to wrap it up, you've got to practice this. So it's just like soft skills, and lots of people are programmers, developers. You really need to train your programming skills. You need to keep up to date, but soft skills is not any different. So, when we think about any practice, usually we think of physical steps. So, we can go running, maybe that empties the mind. But to become a champion or highly successful, we can do 5 additional practices. So, we can watch our speech or self-talk. We make positive use of the senses. We do positive thinking. Imagination and feeling the experience of future success in the present moment as if it has already happened. And this is something that I found particularly strong. So if you can visualize what you want or what you want to be, not tomorrow, but maybe in a year or 2 years, this is a very strong thing. So No, there's not much. I don't know an apple, but it was the best slide I had. You've got to use your imagination. So we play, we practice, we experience. Thank you. It was way too short.
Thank you very much, Ben. Are there any questions for him? I'll bring the mic.